Hello and welcome to Aging Matters. This is a show that's provided by and sponsored by the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. My name is Ann Barlet. I'm the Public Advocacy and Outreach Manager for the agency. Our show today is a comparison between a personal care home and those services and a nursing home and those services. And my two guests with me today, to my immediate left is Lisette Mendez, and to her left is Carolyn Pertie. Both of them are ombudsmen for the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. Thank you for being here. Appreciate your time. And we have a lot to cover today. So I think what we're going to first start with is they may have heard me say that you are ombudsmen. I think I need to spell that too. O-M-B-U-D-S-M-A-N, ombudsman. And that is, we know, is a Swedish word, and it means citizen advocate. I'm going to ask Lisette if you'll just tell me a little bit more about kind of some of the things that you do. What does an ombudsman do?
Okay, like Anne, as you mentioned, we are advocates. So in my case, or in our case, we are representatives or advocates for those that are in long-term care facilities. And that would include your personal care home, your skilled nursing facilities, and adult daily living centers. And with the permission of the resident, when we know that there's a concern and that concern can come from the family, resident, or any caller, we would have to meet with that resident first to see if they would want us to get involved to help advocate. And during that time, we would ask, you know, who did they speak to in the facility that they're in? What was their concern? How did they try to resolve it? So we are like a mediator for that individual with the permission of the resident. And so we help advocate. We also do resident rights training to both the residents as well as the staff. And we also do what we call the quality assurance visits or the facility coverage visits, which means we go into these facilities and we go unannounced and we just talk with residents, see what concerns they have, see how things are going, and then report back to the ombudsman program.
Okay. Well, it's a lot. I know it's a lot, and it's hard to cover everything that an ombudsman does or gets asked to do. But I think to use our time wisely, and I think what we have heard and the phone calls that the agency has received, there are some misconceptions about long-term care facilities, what it is that they provide, don't provide, who's part of the staffing of those places, the costs. I think there's so much around that is, people are unaware. You tend to not look into that until you absolutely need it. It's not like I'm scouring now for my nursing home. a lot of folks find themselves in an emergency situation having to make some decisions, or after a series of incidences, looking then at what is that? So hopefully we can provide some insight today to help people understand a little bit more and maybe have a better direction initially, which is also what you do, provide directions and resources for a variety of things. So I'd like to talk about then, we'll make a comparison between personal care homes and nursing homes. And I think that's one of the things I want to mention is that we need to be mindful that this is someone's new home. They've now made either of those their permanent home in most cases. And so they need to have those rights that you mentioned, that they are people, that they have certain rights there, and the way things should be done, they should have those expectations. So let's kind of focus on, Lisette, you're going to be the tell us about the personal care home piece and the comparison then with Carolyn. We'll talk about the nursing home information about that same question. So let's just really start with basics. We're going to talk specifically about Berks County, so we have both personal care and nursing homes. About how many do we have of each?
Okay, I can tell you with personal care homes, we have 27 in Berks County.
All righty. and nursing homes.
And much fewer nursing homes, 15 of them in the county.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. And I think we think that more people call for nursing home placement, right? And we're not sure that they're really in target for that. So I think it's good that we're going to define each of those better. Let's make this clear, too, that the Area Agency on Aging does not own, manage, operate, fund any of those here in Berks County, nor do we license them for operations. Can you tell us then who does that? Who operates, who licenses those facilities if they are licensed?
Sure. So with personal care homes, the Department of Human Services is the agency that regulates these facilities and does their annual inspection.
Okay.
And for nursing homes, it's the Pennsylvania Department of Health. They come in for both an annual, what they call a survey or inspection, as well as if complaints come in, to be doing any kind of investigation.
And I'm not gonna address it here, but to let folks know that if they did need to reach out to either of these two state departments, they can call us for that information. They can call the Area Agency on Aging. Okay.
Absolutely.
Moving along then, I guess what is probably the first puzzlement is, well, I don't want to be there, but how do I get in if I have to go there?
Right.
In other words, you know, what either tends to lead up to the circumstance, or is there a lot of paperwork required? You know, who does one contact if you think, oh, you know, does this person need nursing home? Well, I don't even know what personal care home is. So maybe we need to start with, let's talk the difference between what I might get first at a personal care home, and then what services, if they're the same or different, in a nursing home or skilled nursing facility.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so with regards to the personal care home, anyone can enter a personal care home as long as they showcase that they might need some minor assistance. You have then some individuals that are in a personal care home that are independent and just choose to move into a personal care home because maybe they want to downsize, or they are living at home and they need some assistance with, like, medication, showers, getting dressed. But with regards to a personal care home, if one would be interested, it would be contacting those personal care homes. What they provide would be your three meals a day, activities, assistance with medication, and the individual going into those personal care homes would not need an assessment to enter.
Okay.
That would be one of the major differences between
personal care homes and
skilled.
So I can look at a list, see where they are, pick up a phone and say, hey, I'd like to come there.
Yep.
Okay. All righty. Mm-hmm. And then how does that work for a nursing home?
So nursing homes are a little bit different, and I would say that we have all received calls from someone who said, well, I fell, I went to the hospital, and then they sent me to such and such place for a rehab stay, and I'm not making progress. They're saying I need to stay here long term. So that is probably one of the most frequent calls we would receive for someone to kind of end up in a nursing home, if you will. But it can also be someone that needs more assistance than they can receive at their personal care home. So that looks a little bit different as well, because you might have some involvement from the personal care home saying, okay, this is what we can and can't provide. It's time really to move on here to somewhere that can provide more assistance. But people can also come to a nursing home directly from their community home if it's become too much for them in their home. As Lisette had mentioned, there is an assessment done by our agency at the Area Agency on Aging, and it goes over what are those things that you are capable of doing for yourself or not to indicate if someone is nursing facility clinically eligible. And that's the outcome you have to have then to be at a nursing home. And without getting into the weeds, eventual payment from medical assistance.
Okay. Yeah, we can talk about, I think each of those would be important to separate by talking about payments, by talking about different aspects of that care. Okay. I'm going to take a moment here and go back to you, Lisette, with personal care, because we're also going to talk a little bit about payment. and what we are having to pay. So when we get into that, there's also one other, Carolyn mentioned medical assistance that could potentially be part of somebody's payment for stay in the nursing home. There's also one other minor opportunity for somebody to also stay in a personal care home. So I think we'll maybe we'll skip and do like payment now. Let's talk about the money piece since that was mentioned. So now that I can pick up the phone and call my personal care home, what can I expect to pay?
Okay, so as I mentioned, there are 27 personal care homes in Berks County. However, not all personal care homes accept a low-income individual. So if you are someone that can pay privately, when you make these calls, the individual on the other side of that phone is gonna ask possibly some information on your income.
Okay.
And I'm gonna tell you that these personal care homes can range anywhere from, I say, $3,000 on up, depending on what your care needs are and what you're looking for. They have smaller rooms to larger rooms, but each facility would have their daily rate, and that's important for the caller to find out if it's something that they can afford in the long run. Because mm-hmm. when you make these calls, if your assets only allow you to be in a facility for a short time, most likely within a few months or maybe 2 years, you would have to transfer to another facility depending on your income, right? So in those 27, only I would say less than a handful accept what we call the SSI supplement. So for the SSI supplement, an individual would have to have an income, a monthly income of under, now I know the rates that we have may have changed since, but it's about $1,580 a month. So if your income is less than that, then you would ask for an assessment. Then in addition to that, you would apply for that SSI supplement. And should you qualify for that, those facilities that accept that SSI supplement, if they would have a bed available, mm-hmm. you would move in. And then now what happens is that person's no longer paying privately, they're paying with that SSI supplement, and they only receive a personal needs allowance of $85. So what happens is the county assistance supplements the difference between what they can bring in monthly and what is needed to come up to that $1,580 a month.
So they're still paying whatever they can, as you said, with their income. It's based on that. So if they're having whatever income, wherever they're getting that from, they're still paying that. This SSI is the supplement to that to bring it up to an acceptable level. And then the personal needs allowance is the PNA you referenced. Mm-hmm. And that's how much for a personal care?
$85 a month.
And they get to keep that.
Correct.
And then therefore use that for?
Some residents that I know use it for toiletries. Some use it for their monthly hair salon appointments. Some use it for outings like luncheons, or some use it for their grandkids. It depends.
Okay.
You
know? It's their choice.
Correct.
To use it. Okay.
Yep.
So is there nothing else for personal care that if someone goes in saying, oh, okay, here are my assets and here's my income, and let's say it's, as you mentioned, $3,000 a month, and I'm paying that, and is there nothing to supplement that? Is there anything that anybody qualifies for, any other subsidy?
Yes, so those that would qualify under the VA aid in attendance, we have the VA office here in Berks County, the Veterans Office, that an individual that believes they might qualify depending on the services that they've had, whether they're a spouse of someone or a person who served, the Veterans Office can express what documents are needed in order to apply, and then they would take that information and then justify if the person can qualify mm-hmm. for that VA aid in attendance. And what that is another supplement to needing personal care home, and then they would help pay for that monthly income. And that can vary, that dollar amount can vary depending on what they can qualify for.
Okay.
But it is through the, it's called the VA aid in attendance.
Okay. And I think the other thing that we're aware of, if anybody has long-term care insurance.
Correct.
If they, as they're looking ahead and considering purchasing long-term care insurance, they want to see exactly what is covered in that, whether it's just, it can be home care in their own home, but it could be applicable to personal care home as well.
Correct.
Okay, but that's it, right?
Yep, that is it.
So now flipping that, let's go to the nursing home situation.
Sure.
And talk about costs. Who's paying for it for me?
Yeah, and this is a misconception we get a lot. You know, people will say, well, Medicare is paying for my stay, which I can kind of get into a little
okay.
bit. So, you know, you can pay privately for a nursing home. However, most of us don't have $14,000 plus a month to pay for that for any period of time. So what most often will happen, someone might come in with their insurance because, as I mentioned before, maybe they're getting rehab services.
Mm-hmm.
So their Medicare okay. or their health insurance is covering a certain portion dependent on how they do at rehab, all sorts of factors. So insurance may cover a bit at the beginning, but then if you're looking to stay there long term, you know, you're paying privately until you reach a threshold of a certain amount of assets that you can start to apply for medical assistance. And I mean, that I don't know how much we really want to get into the nitty gritty of that, but it does require quite a lot of paperwork, quite a lot of bank statements.
Mm-hmm.
But essentially then, once you have applied for medical assistance and you're approved, very similar to the supplement that Lisette was talking about, your stay will be paid for. However, you are essentially giving the facility all of your monthly income. And in exchange, you're just getting $45 a month. Lisette had said $85 for personal care. In a nursing home, it is less than that, $45 a month. Personal needs allowance. And you want to consider as well, are there any additional costs there? So are you paying for your barber trip? Are you paying, do they cable, phone, that kind of a thing? So it looks a little different than personal care.
And so initially, if I do have a decent number of amount of assets, mm-hmm. income and assets, I have to use that.
Right.
I can't just
right.
bank it and say, oh, you know, I'll give you my income, but no, I have to use that. So I actually am paying out of pocket until I, as you said,
right.
I reach a threshold, and then
right.
hopefully medical assistance will come in and assist me
yeah.
in paying for that
right.
stay.
And most nursing homes have a business office that
okay.
is able to manage that process either with the resident or with their responsible party to say, hey, when you hit this number, let us know. We'll walk you through kind of what that process looks like and where to submit things.
And I know that sometimes we have a misconception here in Berks County that there's only one or two nursing homes that accept this Medicaid or medical assistance.
Right.
Can you tell us if that's a...
So
fact or not.
All of our nursing homes in the county, except for one,
okay.
The Highlands is the only one that does not accept medical assistance
okay.
or Medicaid. Everybody else does. So
okay.
yes, thank you for the clarification.
Okay. Good. All righty, moving right along. And so real quick, in terms of admission, so I can just move into personal care. How do I know what I'm getting? Is there an agreement? There's a contract? Same thing with the nursing home.
Yes, so each personal care home would have a contract or an agreement that we encourage the resident to be a part of in reviewing the contract if they have, you know, someone that they can go and review the paperwork with them so that they know what they're signing. And, you know, I encourage, regardless on what personal care home it is, that you not only see what you're signing, read what you're signing, but go and visit the facility and
prior to,
mm-hmm. yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, and then therefore understanding what it is, and I think that we, when we talk about leaving, let's say I get tired and I want to leave, or I've changed my mind because my best friend is over in another facility, usually within that contract, because this is another question I think that we get asked a lot, is what happens? Am I bound there forever or what?
Well, no, so they're not bound there forever. In a personal care home, I would say visitations are definitely much looser, and the ability to go out is much looser than skilled nursing facility. A person living in a personal care home would have the ability to go out and do outings with family or on their own, but should they want to leave the facility and now move to another facility or possibly move out with family, they would just want to give a 30-day notice indicating that they choose to move, and it's good to, you know, have that so that the facility can't say, well, based on your contract, you decided to move yesterday and you've not given us a 30-day notice. So,
and with that in writing, and I think some of the clarification is so that it's also based on that payment piece.
Correct.
So giving a 30-day notice gives you an end date, so indicating I'm not going to really pay beyond that. I expect to be out.
That's right.
Okay. So nursing home, let's talk about that. And if you can make the comparison there then.
Sure. So the nursing home looks a little bit different here. If you think of it, it is more of a medical setting, less home-like. So before you leave, let's say you are ready to go back to your community home, you're going to go live with your daughter, you need to meet with the interdisciplinary team at the facility. So that might include the social worker, the charge nurse, the dietitian, the therapy team, to discuss what are the things that are going to be put in place once you leave here to make sure you're safe. Are we going to get someone in place for home care? How are you getting your medications? Who's providing the food? All of those types of conversations are to be had. And then getting a physician order is probably the golden ticket, right? I mean, we have to have the physician say, yes, this is a safe discharge. And that safe discharge really is the key there. If we're looking at transferring from one nursing home to another, so just a transfer,
so I can
we
do
might
that.
Call it.
Okay.
Yes,
right.
Yes. If you are at a home and you say this is just not a good fit, let's say I speak Spanish, there aren't many other Spanish-speaking residents here, but I know of one across the county that I think would be a better fit, more people that are speaking Spanish, and I'd be much more comfortable. You can request, usually we say speak to the social worker. They're the ones who would make a referral, we would call it. Kind of gather up the clinical paperwork, send it over to the facility you want to go to, and they look at it and decide, do they have room for you? Are they able to meet your needs? That kind of a thing.
Okay. We have a couple minutes. Let's quickly go through visitation, because you mentioned that, Lisette, as far as visitation. So am I locked in? How do people visit? Yeah. And so on. Let's quickly do that.
So with visitations in personal care home, again, it would be no different than if you were visiting mom or dad in their community home. Now, if they share that room with a roommate, it's always important to know that if you're visiting, that you're respectful to the roommate as well. But in most cases, it's just coming in. At times, they might have a sign-in sheet that you would sign in. And for those that work different hours than most, and prefer to visit mom or dad on the outside visiting hours, they can still visit, but they want to make sure they connect with the staff to see, you know, what entrance do they use to come into the facility. Same thing as if a resident would want to go out with their family, say even on a, like we're gonna be having a holiday soon. So they could say to the facility staff, my daughter's picking me up this Friday and bringing me back on Sunday. It's good for that facility to know this so that they can send that resident home with medication and anything else that needs to be said. It's not a restrictive environment. You know, residents have that ability to come and go as they wish.
Okay, thank you. And nursing homes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, similarly with nursing homes for visitation, typically people are welcome to come and go, but you have to be mindful of what the resident prefers. You have to be mindful of what their policies are there. Perhaps they ask visitors don't come after 8 p.m. and sometimes there's wiggle room there, sometimes there isn't, but they do have the right to those visitors, just like a personal care home.
We have a couple minutes. Let's quickly, just in 1 minute, both of you, if you can tell me about how do I see my doctor, and then medications. Let's group both of those in. Quick minute.
So if a resident in a personal care home would want to see their physician, they can do that by either contacting their own physician or checking with like a care coordinator or someone in the facility that can make that connection to see their physician if they have their own PCP, or in some cases they would have a physician at the facility if they choose to go with that physician. And then with medications, individuals in a personal care home that wish to self-medicate, they have to be assessed in order to state that they can safely administer. And if they can and the doctor has signed off on it, then yes, that individual could take their own meds. But if not, there's facility staff, med techs that would provide the medications.
All righty. And in nursing homes?
Sure. With a nursing home, there's typically a medical director or a physician that is there on site. That's usually who the facility is going to encourage you to use, but you can go outside and use your own physician if you would like to. Similarly with medications, with the proper approval of the interdisciplinary team, physician's orders, some other safeguards in place, keeping things locked, you can self-administer. Usually it's not suggested, but you can.
Well, I think sometimes there gets too complicated. There's a lot that at that point, usually in a nursing home, where there are a lot of medical diagnosis requiring a lot of different medications, and sometimes, you know, we know that people just go, oh, I don't
sometimes
care.
Sometimes it's not worth it.
So, yeah. In the last minute we have, let's quickly talk about staffing. There's a concern, I think, that we get a lot about staffing. So if you could give us a brief thing on staffing with personal care.
Yeah, so with personal care homes, they should have an administrator, of course, and that administrator should be in the building at least 20 hours per that week. With regards to ratios, staffing to residents, there are no ratios for that, unlike skilled nursing facilities, which are a lot more stringent.
Mm-hmm. And the direct care staff are non-certified. They're care aides, whatever they deem calling the direct care workers, don't have to have that certification. They have to be trained.
Correct.
But they don't have to be following and pass that special certification.
That's correct.
And there is an overall building kind of staffing based on residents.
Correct.
Okay. And then a nursing home.
So with nursing home, there is a little bit more emphasis on the certification or the titles of the caregivers. So most often you're going to see the registered nurses, the licensed practical nurses, the certified nursing assistants as well. The Department of Health lays out what the ratios are. There was a recent increase in Pennsylvania in 2023, and we're going to see another increase from them in 2024 as well.
Okay. Well, we've covered a lot in the 30 minutes that we had, and I know that we could talk about a lot more things. So what I'm going to say to folks that want to know more, or we didn't clarify certain things or more in-depth questions, please feel free to call our agency, the Berks County Area Agency on Aging, at 610-478-6500. Ask for an ombudsman to help answer any further questions, clarify some things we may have said, as well as if you are interested in receiving either of the lists of personal care homes or nursing homes that are here in Berks County. We have those available and would be happy to send them out to you. So thank you, Lisette and Carolyn, for sharing this great information, and thank you for tuning in to Aging Matters.